Balak the son of Zippor, king of Moab, arose in war against Israel and sent and called Balaam the son of Beor to curse you. But I would not hearken unto Balaam, therefore he blessed you still. What God did, when Balaam went to curse Israel, God sent an angel out there and stopped him with a sword in his hand. As Balaam was going to curse Israel, and God knew Israel was weak, they didn't have the Holy Ghost, they wasn't saved. They would have got so disgruntled and so depressed, they would have turned back to Egypt. And God, so Balaam was going to come, a man had paid money. You go curse these folks because they're going to believe what you say anyway. Let me tell you something. That's what you do when you believe. You believe you get on the prayer shawl, you're going to be blessed. You wear that shawl all around your head and still the same old way. I guarantee you, you get on your face and call on God with a sincere heart, you'll see results immediately. Immediately. You can't pay money for God's blessing on your life. These are schemes of preachers. You can't pray for God to bless you by sending for the oil. This Bible don't say you send for no oil nowhere. It didn't tell you you wear the prayer cloth on your back and all around you and that's going to deliver you. The TV programs, the radio programs is everything we can drain money from you for. And you stay the same way. God didn't suffer that foolishness to a people that was ready to serve him. So he stopped Balaam. As Balaam was going, many of y'all read the story, the angel was standing in the way to cut off Balaam's head. But Balaam couldn't see it. And the donkey that he was riding on saw it and turned aside into the wall. And Balaam kicked his donkey and began to curse it. Get on back in here. And he started riding again. He went to another place. And the Bible said a donkey turned around and went into the other side. And Balaam got so mad and went to cussing him more and more. And the donkey started riding again. The donkey went up this time. That angel was standing right in the way to cut his head off. And that donkey fell down on his knees. And the donkey turned around and spoke like a man to Balaam. Said, now, haven't I been your donkey all these years? I'm telling this is real. Haven't I been your donkey all these years you rode? When haven't I always done what you said? Why are you doing that to me? Balaam went to cussing him. Now that'd have been enough to shock me off that. Wait a minute. But instead, when sin is in your eyes, when you got desire you want to do and someone is trying to stop you, you'll get mad at that person. Many people anger me all the time because I'm trying to correct them. I'm trying to show them how to be better, how to act with others, how to treat others, how to minister sometime, how to correct people. I was just in the office today talking with a young man. I said, you know, you got a few things in your environment. You need to correct this. It's not because I hate the people. I'm trying to show you how to live. Hallelujah. I had one brother come to me. He said, you spared me and my family. My wife is saved today. He said, I was telling him, your wife should respect me so much, brother. I said, she loves a bishop. He said, I'm going to tell you why she loves him. He said, because you made a man out of me. So my wife did some, doing some of everything. So my wife would get to the point she was staying away, smoking dope, everything. But you told me to stand up against that stuff and don't lie to her. And I stood up. And when she saw that change in my life, she said, what done happened to my husband? I got to go over there and see what he got. I got to get some of this stuff myself. I'm going to tell you something. God will make a change in your life. Shout glory to God when somebody is standing there to show you the right way. Show you the right way. Hallelujah. But what happens to you when you don't want to do anything, you don't want to change? You get mad at the messenger. It happens to me all the time. I see it. I be preaching. I see they get mad at me. Be preaching. Then sit there and get quiet. Hey, you're popping up. I'm not up here to try to hurt you. Man, I got too many things to do that are good. Why would I be trying to spend my time to hurt a person? But I'm charged by God. I got to show you their transgressions. I got to tell them to you. My God. I done come too far through too many things to sit here and let you by in my presence and go to hell for not telling you the truth. I read these scriptures. That's what make me scared. Well, I tell you what, that donkey with the talking. Said, man, you don't hit me. And I've been a faithful donkey to you. And you hit me with all this many times and battling with his crazy self. That's how sin is. The more somebody try to explain what they're going, the more the preacher try to explain himself, the madder you get. And Balaam got more mad. Said, you know what? You talking about me hitting you with this stick. If I had a sword in my hand, I'd kill you. About that time, God opened the eyes of Balaam. And he saw an angel standing there with a drawn sword to cut his heads off. And that angel said to him, hey, your ways are perverse before God. And I was sent out to prevent you. Said, but the donkey saw me and turned aside. You need somebody that can see. You don't need somebody that's just a friend and a buddy and a pal. You need somebody that can see your wretchedness and not trust your own little self. Telling you. That's why when they choose jurors, they try to get people that ain't been involved, the preconceived ideas. Because they can't judge correctly. Balaam, that angel said, I was sent out. He said, if that donkey hadn't have seen me, I was fixing to cut your head clean off of you. Don't tell me what God won't do when somebody go to messing with his people. Hallelujah. That was about the end of him. He came so close. Balaam then began to repent. The sad thing about me, I just want to see people get it right. If they get it right, I'm just as happy. I don't care what they did wrong. Because that's how God is. I don't have to pray to forgive you. I done already forgave you. I don't tell you about your wrong because I'm mad at you. The fact of the matter, when I did my children, I wouldn't even whoop them if I was really upset. Out of control, I wasn't going to chastise you because I was going to impose something on you that came out of anger and it wasn't going to be for the correcting of the child. So certainly being saved and the condition I'm in today, I would do nothing to you to hurt you knowingly. Sometimes the truth real hurt. But it is the truth that'll make you free. Balaam, when he was fell down, the same, we see illustrations of this all through the Bible. We see where Paul was on his way to kill the Christians. Man, thinking them been committed to God, been in seminary, the top seminary in that day, the school of Gamaliel. Learned all the laws and the Torah. You had to quote it. He learned it and still wrong with his mind. But as he was on his way to try to do God's service, a light shined from heaven and knocked him to the earth. Don't resist God when he's trying to help you. Knocked him to the earth. You can go, you will always feel bad when you get knocked down. You always feel bad when the word is coming and finding you and correcting you. You always can find a better way it should have been done. If he'd have said it like this, should have said it like that. If he wouldn't have just been so direct to me. The bottom line, you need to be thankful that God brought it to you however he did. Let God deal with him. Let God show me a more perfect way to do it. I welcome that. I'll always look for that. And I seek for it before I speak to you. It don't always be the perfect way. I always go home and examine it. And sometimes I said, I could have maybe said that differently. The next time I learn, even a better way that you might be able to digest it. But you need to see the heart. And you need not to forget the heart of your instructor. Because now you're standing in a path that he's got to stop you. I've always told you, when you're doing things, you're thinking of God in the right way, you're going to love me. But when you start getting out of the way, and that's for everyone here, and I see this Bible is telling me to stir you back on path, you don't watch yourself, you get mad at me. You don't watch yourself, you'll leave me. You don't watch yourself, you'll talk about me. And you forget the heart of things that you rejoice until you were the object that needed to be corrected. I wouldn't want a pastor that never could show me better ways. I wouldn't want to go to church, and every time I went in there, I was puffed up in everything. I felt good when I went out. I want that message sometime to bring me on my knees. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I've learned wisdom. In my early church, I stand you up and rebuke you right in the whole church. You know it, don't you, brother? Brother so-and-so, come on up here and repent right now. Get right there. You know why? I thought I was doing the will of God. Why could you think that? I read where the Bible said, him that sinned rebuked before all that others of fear. But that's how you are when you're superficial in God's word too. That's why you got to always, including myself, have a heart to learn. As I grew in God, I understood what Paul was talking about. He wasn't talking about the congregation, get each individual out and rebuke them. He was talking about preachers that you have set in authority. Don't just correct them personally one-on-one because they done spreaded this foolishness among everybody else and among other pastors. You got to get them among all the pastors, and then you got to correct this thing in the front of the whole church and assembly because they have been taught something wrong. He wasn't talking about the little sister or the little brother that had gone through some trouble in their marriage. And you get them up in the front. Hallelujah. But that's all right. For as you're concerned, it just make you better. It make you stronger. You know, it make you more compassionate on others too. Well, I got all kind of rebukes. I had my pastor get me up and say, hey, man, I remember the time Brother Wonder was seeking God before God, man, going after God. And I got all my church there. I done brought my whole big church to be in his church. I remember the time Brother Wonder was seeking God and going after God. He bought now sitting down watching television. I said, oh, Lord. He said, went on to preach. He began to talk and say, you know, Brother Wonder was preaching last night how he cast out devils. You know what? I understand him because, you see, I cast out the devil out of him. But those was unnecessary pains for me. But guess what I did? Every time I saw my pastor do something that hurt me dearly, I knew he didn't mean no harm. I embraced it. But I said, I tell you what, I'm going to do that differently. If I have to do that, I ain't going to never get up before somebody and say I cast the devil out of them. But I learned in every pain that you go through, you'll learn all the time the things may be good, instruction may be something intended well. But if it has that diverse effect on you, you don't stop doing what was done that's good. You learn how to do it differently and better. Hallelujah. Let's read on down. So God, when God stopped Balaam, Balaam turned around. Balaam said, Lord, what would you want me to do? He said, get on up and go on to Israel like you were going. But instead, the words that I put in your mouth, that shall you speak. This is probably the only true thing that came from God that prophet spoke when he went to Israel and said, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should spend. He said, I've been hired, and Balak told me and paid me to go curse Israel and divide Jacob. But how can I defy what God hasn't defied? How can I curse what God has not cursed? People, let me tell you something. No witchcraft person can curse you when God ain't curse you. No witchcraft person can defy what God has strengthened. Don't even fear it. He said he has not beheld iniquity in Jacob. Neither have he seen perverseness in Israel. Then he said, blessed is he that blesses thee. Cursed be he that curses thee. He said, when I die, let me die the death of the righteous. Though this man spoke all kind of good things, but that was about the end of his speaking. You don't find no book of Balaam in the Bible. His prophecies will show you God can make a donkey talk. He can make a witchcraft man change his mind. What I'm trying to tell you, saint, don't worry about nobody. When God is for you, who can be against you? But let me get on to this message here. Hallelujah. Verse number 24, verse 14. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. Now we have got to understand the Christian community have adapted to gods that's been served of other cultures. Don't think this was only to them, it's also to you. You wonder why I don't have a Christmas tree. It's because I know the origin of it. I know that it is an idol worship that was worshipped by the Scandinavian and adapted by many countries as the actually God, because it was able to stay green in the winter. And many cultures worship it as a tree. They will take it and put silver and gold upon it. God spoke about that in Jeremiah 10. I preached that to you all last week. God spoke, said, don't you learn their ways. All of the things that God has not told me to do, I do not teach it to the church. And I do not go out and gravitate to what the world is doing and stick up as very important and believe this is what God wants me to bring back to you. He will not bless something like that. Listen what he said. He said, put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose ye this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your father served, and some of you got mothers and fathers and friends, co-workers, job people. You can choose. It's your choice. And Bishop will always give you that choice. I will never talk to you any kind of way because you choose the choice you want. But I got the God you want. But I got to share with you how God feel about that. If you seem evil for you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood or in the flood are the gods of the Amorites in whom land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. This is what Joshua is saying. I have decided, and my family likewise feel the same way I feel. We are not going to adapt to these other gods and bring their way of doing things into God Almighty's methods. We're not going to do it. And the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord and serve other gods. Now, I want to go with me, if you would, to the book of Deuteronomy. And we're going to chapter 12. And we're going into verse 29. Let's go to verse 28. This is Moses speaking. Observe and hear all these words which I command thee, that it may go well with thee and with thy children after thee forever. Man, here's God telling you, you can observe his words and things will go well with you, with your children. Even you think an insurance policy is better? Let me tell you something. Serving God and choosing to serve God correct is better for your children's estate even after you're gone. Huh? Do you read your Bible how God suffered nobody to do Israel's wrong because of sometimes David's sake, sometimes because of Abraham? All throughout this Bible, God protected their offspring based on those parents' commitment to him in truth. I've had some of my children testify, say, God even told them, say, hey, I delivered you today because your father and mother's prayer. Only reason why you're free. Hallelujah. Terrible situations. Well, you can live those ways yourself. But your kids go to school in that bad environment where I was just talking with some of the people today, some of the people in our ministry that have to deal with schools and security. And they were saying to me, hey, these kids nowadays are feel threatened if they don't join a gang in school. If you don't join a gang sometime, they jump on your kids and beat them up. That's why it's so much violence today and so much robbery, because these kids are forced by other kids to do things and to develop them into a mean spirit attitude. But your children got to come up in these environments. But if you do what God said, God will keep your child. So oftentimes we see our children love God, want to be at church, enjoy church, go to college, get with an athlete, get with a girlfriend. And all of a sudden they show up and say, Daddy, you know our religion is right. You sure you wasn't taught that by fear? You know, I'm learning in science that the people made the folks afraid and made them believe in God. And the very child that done seen miracles and healings, know God is with them now, they are doing things to hurt their own lives. But these things are promising that your children would be well. If you observe to do all that God commanded you, hallelujah. Whether you're old and whether you're sick, whether you feel you ain't gonna be around long, whether your child may be in another land, you do these things that God says. Stay faithful to him. I'm a living witness. Now he will leave it up to your children to serve them. He makes nobody serve him. But I promise you, he'll take care of them. He'll keep them. Hallelujah. Look what he says. My God, verse 29. With the Lord thy God shall have cut off the nations from before thee, whether thou goest to possess them, and thou succeedest them, and dwell in their land, you dwell with them. Take heed to thyself, that thou be not snared by following them after they be subdued from before thee, and that thou inquire not after their gods, saying, how did these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. This is why you have the goddess of the spring, Easter. Because the spring goddess people always believe that the goddess of the spring, Estria, she is supposed to have laid an egg. The earth hatched out of the egg. And every year she comes in and she huffs and puffs and blows the winter away. The people that believe in this goddess of the spring, which we now call Easter, they will wait to Easter to wear their spring clothing. Because they believe that the goddess of the spring have not given clearance to accept the winter is gone until she steps in and blows it away. Church folks alike will wait to that day and they have adapted to that pattern that did not come from this Bible at all. And when the minister that stands in the way steps up and show them the truth, they'll hate him. They'll walk out of his church while he's yet speaking. Because they'll look at it and say, well, look at all the people of the land. But God is telling you, when the people of the land start doing things, you don't inquire and say, we're going to do the same thing to God. Now just think about this. What bigger lie? Jesus Christ raises on Easter. Sometime it comes in March, and sometime it comes in April. How is the world your birthday going to be sometime in March and sometime in April? How is an anniversary you have sometime in March and sometime in April? You ought to know right there that is a lie. You ought to know that. Now, but I can tell you why you get your Easter sometime in March and sometime in April. Because of the truth, it is the goddess of the spring. You have to wait till after spring. Also, she's called the goddess of fertility. She causes all of the flowers to bloom. She causes all of the reproduction. And during the celebration of this Easter celebration, it always had to be a full moon, because a full moon has a gravitational pull on water. Your body is 75% water. And that's why the tides rise during a full moon. And guess what? Your tide rise. Your excitement gets alive. So they always have to wait for the full moon, because that's when people are more sexually active. Because what they did during this great celebration, they would always come into the temple of the great goddess, and they would have free sex, sex here and sex there. And the eggs was to illustrate the reproduction that was coming. Now, here's the church got this going on. And let me tell you why you got to wait till sometime in March and April, because spring comes in March the 22nd. So you have to wait till after March the 22nd to have your Easter. But then you have to wait for a full moon to come in. You can't just have it after the spring day. You got to wait till spring, and then you got to wait till the full moon come in. And then the first Sunday after the first full moon in spring is always your Easter. And sometimes they just have all kind of dates, because it is in direct response to the celebration of the goddess of the spring. Why do the church do such a thing? Hallelujah. He said, thou shalt, verse 30, thou shalt not do unto the Lord thy God. He said, the things that these nations do, verse 31, thou shalt not do unto the Lord thy God, for every abomination to the Lord which he hated have they done unto their gods. Even their sons and their daughters they have burnt in the fire to their gods. Now this is what he tells you. What things soever I command you, observe to do it. Thou shalt not add thereunto, nor diminish from it. What God wants us to do is not build our own religion. Not build our own way of worship and what seems good and fun and festivity for us. But let us learn to love what his word says. Let us learn to commit to what his word says and do it.